COVID-19 pandemic. Our Tuesday morning report tomorrow will capture the data from Saturday, Sunday, and Monday. Just a couple of points to put that recent case growth into context. Over the last 2 months, we've seen the total number of COVID cases that have gone up in the past 2 months. Fully almost half of those cases in the last 2 months have been identified in the last 2 weeks. And similarly, of all the hospitalized cases that have happened in the past 2 months, just about a third of those cases have happened in the last 2 weeks. So just to kind of put the recent growth in context for you. As Mike mentioned, we wanted to spend a little bit more time today talking about questions that have arisen about the CDC guidance regarding county-level rates of transmission and masking recommendations. We wanted to talk a little bit more about how that relates to what we're seeing here in Minnesota. But the first thing to remind us of, and CDC certainly has said this as well, the number one thing we can do to reduce our risks and to slow the spread of COVID-19 and this surge that we're now seeing is to get vaccinated. CDC's updated guidance and recommendations on masking is really in light of the dramatic increase in cases happening around the country, driven almost entirely by the highly infectious Delta variant, as CDC has reported that over 80% of U.S. cases are now from the Delta variant. And I think we've said here in Minnesota that is 85% by our current estimates. And this is really an unfortunate development, obviously, after seeing so much progress this spring and early summer. Heading back up in case counts is a direction no one wanted to go. Much of the national attention has focused on the southern states, Florida, Texas, some of the other states where not only case numbers are very high, but the healthcare systems are getting very stressed again. But we're also seeing, as we've talked about, rises in cases among unvaccinated Minnesotans at the same time. So we do share CDC's concern about rising case numbers and about the importance of the Delta variant. And we have recommended that Minnesotans follow the CDC recommendations to wear masks when in an indoor public setting, when you're in an area seeing substantial or high rates of COVID-19 transmission. As you're probably aware, the list of counties that CDC categorizes as substantial or high spread in Minnesota continues to grow. We started out at 14 counties in substantial or high spread when CDC first announced their guidance. We're now up to 44 counties with either substantial or high spread. The high spread counties, there's six of them, are Dodge, Lake, Meeker, Rock, Traverse, and Wilkin. The metro counties are all in the substantial category. Only 8 Minnesota counties are still in the low transmission range. Those counties are Carlton, Cook, Cottonwood, Grant, Coochicheng, Manoman, Red Lake, and Watonwan. 8 counties. You can find this county information at www.cdc.gov, or you can access it from our MDH website by looking at the menu of featured COVID-19 information on the right side of the MDH homepage. There's a link to the CDC COVID data tracker. CDC updates this information at 7 p.m. Central Time each evening. One of the things we've learned over the last year and a half is that this is a very opportunistic virus. It finds our weak spots and takes advantage of them in a way we haven't seen many viruses do in recent decades. This is why it's so important that we all have to do our part to shore up those weak spots if we want to minimize the impacts of COVID. And again, by far, the best thing we can do is to make sure that we and our family members are vaccinated as soon as we become eligible. And just to remind you, the governor announced last week that the state has joined President Biden's call for incentive programs. So we're now offering a $100 incentive for each person to get vaccinated over the next little over 2 weeks. So for instance, if you're a family of 5 people who are eligible but not yet vaccinated, that's $500 you can put in your pockets right now. We hope that that's helpful to many families. To this point, we know that there are questions about why CDC and other public health officials like us at MDH are now once again suggesting that people who are fully vaccinated go back to wearing masks when they're indoors in these counties with substantial or high rates of transmission. First, we just want to underscore again that this does not mean that the vaccines are not doing their job. The data continue to show that the vaccines are safe and highly effective, not only at preventing infection, but especially at preventing serious illness if you are one of the quite rare breakthrough cases. Getting vaccinated as soon as you're eligible is the single best thing you can do to protect yourself, your family, and your community. Just this morning, we saw some data from the Kaiser Family Foundation, who looked at 25 states. Minnesota was not one of them, but our data track very closely to this. So the Kaiser data looked at breakthrough cases, hospitalizations, and deaths, and just confirmed that these are extremely rare events among those who are fully vaccinated against COVID-19. The rate of breakthrough cases reported among those fully vaccinated in those 25 states is well below 1% in every reporting state, ranging from a low of 0.01%, 1/100th of a percent in Connecticut, to 0.90% in Oklahoma, 0.9%. The hospitalization rate among fully vaccinated people with COVID-19 ranged from effectively zero in California, Delaware, and a number of other states, to a high of only 0.06% in Arkansas, 0.06%. For hospitalizations. And the same is true for the rates of death among fully vaccinated people, effectively zero in all but two reporting states where they were 0.01%. Again, Minnesota was not part of the Kaiser data set, but we are seeing similar evidence of the vaccine's effectiveness here. Out of nearly 3 million Minnesotans fully vaccinated, we've documented 4,477 breakthrough cases to date. That is far less than 1% of the total people who have been vaccinated who've gone on to get COVID after vaccination. Of those rare breakthrough cases, far less than 1%, we've seen 455 people hospitalized and 56 deaths. That's 0.016% hospitalized and 0.002% of deaths. And that is just amazing evidence of the effectiveness and protection conferred by these vaccines. So I know a lot of people are wondering, so if the vaccines are so effective, why do we still need to go back to masking once we're fully vaccinated? And to understand that, it's just important to remember that masking is not only about protecting you, it's about protecting everyone around you as well. As we've just talked about, if you're vaccinated, it is very unlikely that you will contract COVID-19. But in rare cases, CDC has found that people who are fully vaccinated can still transmit the virus to others, even if they don't develop symptoms themselves. This small risk, plus the fact that we have a very contagious Delta variant circulating widely, plus the fact that in many parts of the country, fewer than half of the eligible people are vaccinated, this makes masking just a smart preventive measure to reduce the risk for all of us and cut down on transmission, just that extra layer of protection against transmission. So our advice to Minnesotans is pretty straightforward. First, if you're eligible for COVID-19 vaccination and you haven't gotten around to it yet, now is surely the time. This Delta variant is a game changer, as CDC has said, and it's more likely than ever that it will find you and make you sick, or just as bad, that you will spread it to people around you who are susceptible if you're not vaccinated. Keep in mind what we've heard from national public health leaders in recent weeks about this latest surge being a pandemic of the unvaccinated. More than 99% of recent deaths were among the unvaccinated, and more than 97% of hospitalizations. And although, as we've talked about, some fully vaccinated people can be contagious if they get the Delta variant, a very small number, remember that CDC estimates that if you get vaccinated, your risk of infection is 3.5 times lower than if you were not vaccinated. Your risk of getting ill from COVID is over 8 times lower. And your risk of being hospitalized or dying from COVID is 25 times lower than if you had not been vaccinated. But again, given the surge that we're seeing in Minnesota and other states, we do think this is a good time to double down on those other preventive measures that also help to reduce transmission, whether or not everyone is vaccinated. That's those tried and true measures that we've been talking about for so long now. Masking up when going to a public indoor setting, if you're in a place, a county with substantial or high transmission, staying home if you're feeling sick, and getting a COVID test when appropriate. So just a little bit more on how the CDC tracks and categorizes counties. The CDC uses two indicators to categorize counties: the total number of new cases per 100,000 persons over the last 7 days. So that is a cumulative weekly number. And second, the percentage of positive tests during that last 7 days. And each of these two indicators have thresholds associated with their levels. For example, high transmission is defined as either 100 or more new cases per 100,000 over the past 7 days, or a test positivity rate of 10% or higher. And they go on to define what low transmission counties mean in terms of the control of the pandemic being achieved largely through individual preventive behaviors and our public health response to help identify and for people to isolate when they are infected. In moderate transmission or yellow counties on the CDC map, adherence to individual and more selected community level prevention strategies are needed. In orange or substantial transmission counties, which is the majority of the Minnesota counties now that are shown on the map, everyday activities are advised to be limited to reduce spread and protect the capacity of the healthcare system. And in red or high transmission areas, significant measures are needed to limit contact between persons, with priority given to maintaining essential community activities and services like healthcare, transportation, schools, food and agriculture. So just a quick note on how these CDC measures compare to the Minnesota public health risk measures that we've been compiling and reporting every day at the state level. So that these thresholds don't perfectly align, but they're close. In general, all of the counties in CDC's high transmission or red category also exceed our Minnesota high risk thresholds for case growth and positivity. And the substantial transmission category captures the high end of our caution threshold. In the Minnesota measures, we look at specimen date of collection as opposed to date the cases reported. And we also look at a 7-day rolling measure of daily average cases. So we're looking at a daily measure. CDC is looking at a weekly measure, for example. But just so folks know that there is good, even though the numbers are different, there's good correlation between what CDC defines as substantial and high risk and what we have categorized as our caution and high risk levels in our risk measures as well. And with that, I'd like to turn it over to Dr. Linfield to talk about updates on treatment options. Dr. Linfield.
Thank you very much, Commissioner. You've heard us talk in the past about some of the treatment options available for some higher risk people, including the use of a treatment that involves the use of monoclonal antibodies. Earlier today, we sent out a message to healthcare providers sharing an update that on Friday afternoon of last week, the FDA authorized an additional use for the COVID-19 monoclonal antibody therapy Regen-CoV, also known as casirivimab and imdevimab. The Regen-CoV emergency use authorization, which was issued at the end of last week, has now been expanded to include post-exposure prophylaxis. This means it can be given to high-risk people who are not fully vaccinated after they have been exposed to someone with SARS-CoV-2 infection, but prior to the development of infection. Regen-CoV is expected to be effective against circulating variants, including the Delta variant. It should be noted that this is not a substitute for vaccination against COVID-19. This kind of treatment is a tool, but treating an unvaccinated person who's been exposed is nowhere near as preferable as the person getting vaccinated. So they are far less likely to need these kinds of treatments. I will also mention that for the group of people who have been vaccinated but are immunocompromised and are thought not to respond well to the vaccine, this treatment is also available to them if they have had an exposure. More information on this can be found on the MDH website and the Minnesota Resource Allocation Platform for COVID-19 Treatments, also known as MNRAP, which is available on the MDH website as well. MNRAP can connect clinicians and patients with information and eligibility criteria for the monoclonal therapies. As you may recall, the earlier emergency use authorizations were for people who tested positive to SARS-CoV-2 and had symptoms and were at risk for hospitalization, and this therapy has been shown to reduce that risk of hospitalization and severe disease. With that, I would like to turn it back to Mike Schomer. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Linfield. Operator, we're ready to take questions.
As a reminder, to ask a question, you will need to press star 1 on your telephone keypad. Again, that's star, then the number 1 on your telephone keypad. Please stand by while we compile the Q&A roster. Your first question comes from the line of Matt Sepik from Minnesota Public Radio News. Your line is now open.
Hi, Commissioner. Even if the governor does not have the authority to issue mask mandates and other sorts of mandates now that he does not have emergency powers, are counties and cities still able to do that under Minnesota law?
Yes, Matt, they are. As you know, MDH is following CDC guidance and strongly recommending to Minnesotans that they do adhere to that guidance. To take necessary steps to mitigate COVID-19. But that it is guidance coming from the CDC and from us. But we have not done anything to limit the ability of local governments to implement requirements if they so choose.
And a follow-up question, too, just regarding masks. A lot of people wearing cloth masks, but I know that there are certainly types of masks that are better and more effective. What are you recommending? What is the CDC recommending on the types of masks that people wear now that we're going back to wearing masks?
You know, I think I'm going to ask Dr. Linfield if she wants to comment on that. I think that, you know, the range of masks that are well-fitting and contain layers of protection continue to be pretty widely available now, and it's pretty easy to find masks that are effective. But Dr. Linfield, what would you say?
Yeah, thank you, Commissioner. That's exactly right. Well-fitting, multi-layer, at least two layers, and we have on our website, specific information and also link to the CDC website, which goes into great detail about masks.
All right. Thank you both.
Your next question comes in the line of Theo Kitts from Fox 9. Your line is now open.
Hi, Commissioner. Long time, no talk. Since you're making a big push here for people to get vaccinated is the number one thing. I noticed last week, for the first time in several weeks, there was an increase in the number of people actually getting a vaccine. Is that backdated? Is that some strange explanation that I wouldn't know? Or was that actually people going out for the first time and getting a shot? And do you chalk that up to people's concerns about Delta?
Hi, Theo. Yes, that those data are quite current. We've only got about a two-day lag between the administration of a vaccine and when it is able to be reported out of our immunization system. So those are pretty current data. And we do believe that this is likely, we don't know for sure, obviously, hard to parse out, but due to the extensive news coverage of the growth in cases nationwide and here in Minnesota, and just the fact that the Delta variant has some new characteristics that make it even more important to increase our protection. So we're grateful that people are taking another look and taking action to get vaccinated.
On masking, I was at the store this weekend and saw, I don't know, maybe 10% of people wearing a mask. Are you concerned, even with CDC's new recommendations, that people are just sort of over it? It's the sense that I sort of get.
Well, I too was in the store with my mask and saw a number of people wearing masks. But I think some of it is just this was new news, you know, from the CDC. And that's part of why we wanted to talk about it again today, just to help people understand what characterizes, you know, substantial and high transmission rates. I think it's, you know, I think the first news out was that we only had, you know, only in quotes, 14 counties in Minnesota that fit the bill, and now we're up to 44, and that number is sure to grow in the coming days. So I think as that news spreads a little more widely, hopefully folks will consider, at least in indoor crowded spaces where they'll be for some period of time, that it's just that extra layer of protection to put that mask back on.
Okay, thanks.
Your next question comes from the line of Greta Call from MeanPost. Your line is now open.
Hi, Commissioner. I'm wondering, just because everything's kind of opened up again, and just watching people grapple with this Delta variant news and what it means for them, how would you recommend somebody who's maybe not super high risk but vaccinated approach going to maybe an event they had planned, like a wedding coming up, and then how would that maybe be different, and how should somebody who might be higher risk approach plans that they've already made that they're maybe now trying to figure out whether it's a good idea?
Well, thanks for the question, Greta. I'm sure a lot of us are in that situation, looking forward to special events and wondering how this might affect things. Again, I think just we wanted to go back over those numbers just to reassure people that the risk benefit of getting vaccinated and the protections against acquiring the virus and even a less likelihood of being able to spread it. So this is not something that needs to just stop everybody in their tracks, particularly if they're lower risk, but it's a great time to just stop and think about whether the people you're going to be with might be in a higher risk situation, or you yourself. So I think it is going to be, a decision that people have to consider based on their own risk factors and those around them. But it's just a sort of an extra measure of caution to consider masking, because you frankly don't know who might be vulnerable around you in those situations. But again, outdoor environments, certainly, much safer. Being also careful to, just be mindful of distance and length of time that you're in proximity.
Thanks. And then I got another question from a reader who was wondering about child infection rates. Have we seen any changes in those with Delta becoming more prevalent recently?
We're looking at, CDC is looking at some international data as well as national. I am not aware of any new specific data that's come out on child infection rates, but I'll see if Dr. Linfield might have any more current information.
Well, certainly in communities that have high rates of infection in general, they are seeing more cases in children. That is to be expected because children are not vaccinated. It is not clear yet if Delta is associated with more severe infection. That is something that, that people are looking at. However, when you have a lot of infections, as is being seen, for example, in Arkansas, they are seeing an increase in pediatric admissions to the hospital because the proportion of those cases are severe.
Thank you.
Your next question comes from the line of Tom Hauser from KSTP-TV. Your line is now open.
Hello, Commissioner. As Theo said, long time, no talk to. Quick question about the University of Minnesota mask guidance that they issued today that will start tomorrow. And Target stores have some new guidance as well. My question is, how effective are these masks, if they're not mandates, but well, I guess in some cases they are requirements that are kind of a hodgepodge, where if you're on a U of M campus or a facility, you need to wear a mask, but the moment you go off it, you're not required to wear a mask. So how effective is this if everybody has a different mask policy and most places do not require them?
Well, hi, Tom. You know, it's a good question, and I think we've talked many a time over these last months about just that it is challenging for the public to understand when there are kind of different approaches and kind of a patchwork approach across the nation or within within communities. And I, that's why we just keep coming back to the fundamental point that the even though we're talking again about masks as another additional layer of protection that that people are encouraged to use and to think about when they're in these higher risk areas, the absolute best thing we can do is just get vaccinated as soon as you're eligible. You know, we've heard educators, parents, you know, talking, you know, very passionately about the value of all of the rest of us who can be vaccinated, getting vaccinated to protect the kids who can't be vaccinated yet, particularly against this Delta variant. So while I think you will see, you know, a number of jurisdictions and organizations encouraging or saying that they're requiring masking in certain environments, it's absolutely still the case that the best protection is just to keep on driving those vaccination rates higher.
Did the University of Minnesota consult with MDH about this move? And did they ask, you know, will this be effective? Do you think this is a good idea? Did they come to you with that? And then as a second part of that question, are we getting any closer to the state trying to implement some kind of a mask mandate? And is that even possible without emergency powers?
I will say that we have staff in our epidemiology section at the health department that spends a lot of time talking with our institutes of higher education across the state. So I wouldn't be surprised at all if there was some conversation with the U. I'm not aware of it personally, but you know, I think everyone is very well aware of what you're saying, that at this point in time, folks are fatigued with masks, and this is not the, you know, the panacea or the end all and be all of how to manage our risk. But it's just a kind of a prudent extra layer of protection. And in terms of whether we're looking at the statewide mandate, the answer to that is no. As you rightly say, the measures that we previously used were authorized by that peacetime emergency, and that has expired. So at this point in time, the best we can do is give people our best advice, our best guidance based on what the CDC is saying is the most current science. But as previously also mentioned, unlike some other states, Minnesota certainly has not done anything to restrict the ability of local units of government or other entities to impose mandates if they so choose.
Okay, thank you for your time.
Your next question comes from the line of Nora Hertel from St. Cloud Times. Your line is now open.
Thank you. I was hoping you could talk about the deaths that were announced today. I noticed that they were all people 70 and older and all linked to long-term care and nursing home or assisted living facilities. Yeah, I'm just wondering if you know if any of those folks are vaccinated, and if you could just comment on whether that's kind of a coincidence to have all that for all six of the deaths today.
Sure, Nora, and I'll ask Dr. Linfield if she wants to comment on this too, but it just in general, we're very glad that we're still seeing, you know, quite good protection, high levels of vaccination among long-term care residents, less good within staff, but that is a lot of work going on to encourage staff members in long-term care to get vaccinated as well. But as cases go up, we do expect to see some increases in long-term care cases. As we've talked about before, as we age, our immune systems tend to be less robust, can have a less robust response to the vaccine. So it's just extra important that that those folks be surrounded by folks who are also vaccinated. So the fact that all of the deaths reported on Friday were among older people is not terribly surprising, but that is a, you know, you'll see those numbers vary from day to day, week to week. That's why we kind of tend to like to look at patterns over longer periods of time, because you'll have days where there's zero or one or two, and then days where there are larger numbers. But again, as cases in general go up, the level of viral activity around vulnerable people goes up, and we could see more cases. Ruth, would you like to add anything?
I think you've covered it very well, Commissioner. Thank you.
Okay, and just Operator. A quick follow-up. We're talking about, you know, cases going up. Is there a point, you know, is this the beginning of death rates going up? I guess when do you expect that indicator to rise as well?
Good question, and you're right that we have typically seen rates of hospitalization rise several weeks after cases are reported to be rising, and then deaths are a further lagging indicator, trailing indicator, following after hospitalizations. But again, as a testament to the vaccine's effectiveness, the data from other countries, as well as so far here in the U.S. and here in Minnesota, we are not seeing the same proportionate rise in the numbers of deaths as we have in prior waves. And that's because the vaccines are highly, highly effective against protecting against severe disease and death. So while we do expect to see all of these numbers, or the hospitalizations and deaths going up, we frankly are very hopeful that the number of deaths proportionately will continue to be much lower thanks to the vaccines.
Okay, thank you.
Operator, we have time for one more question.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, sorry, go ahead, Ruth.
This is Ruth. I just, you know, I looked up the six deaths that were reported on Friday, and actually five of the six were deaths that had occurred previously, more than a month prior. It just took a little while to get the data. So I thought that was useful information for you to know.
Thanks, Ruth.
All right.
Mike, you said we have time for one more?
Yeah, I was just going to say we have time for one more question at this point.
All right. Our last question comes in the line of Jeremy Olson from Star Tribune. Your line is now open.
Hi. I wanted to ask about the CDC mask guidance and recommendations, because they come with some volatility. And yes, the number of counties that already have substantial or high transmission rates has grown, but some counties also got dropped off from that initial list and haven't reappeared, if I'm not mistaken. With that kind of volatility, it'd be kind of hard for a county to flip the switch off and on, it would seem like, you know, or for organizations within a county to do that kind of switching back and forth. Are you giving any advice to public health people or others on how to manage that volatility as they potentially have a county, you know, especially a smaller place, that kind of switches on and off those transmission levels?
Jeremy, it's a good point that counties with smaller populations might tend to, those numbers might tend to move, because it's all on a per population basis. So I think we're, you know, certainly talking with our colleagues in local public health about, you know, just the fact that, you know, these data are fairly new, or at least this characterization by CDC, and just how to make the best use of the data. I think the point, though, for folks is there's just a lot of virus moving around the country, and it's here in Minnesota as well. It is this new, much more transmissible Delta variant. So it's just a good idea to kind of heighten our alert and pay attention to some of those basic preventive strategies that we know help to diminish transmission. But the main number one message is, again, with the increase in transmissibility and apparently severity from Delta, it's just more important than ever to get good information, talk to people you trust about the benefits of vaccine, and take advantage of those incentives.
If I may, with a follow-up question, you know, more than a year ago, when we talked about masking, it was in the context of three things, saying masking alone wasn't enough. Masking in combination with social distancing and staying home when sick was kind of the three-headed way to reduce transmission. And now all they're doing is talking about masking again, and some of this context beyond vaccination, obviously. I'm just wondering if all of this talk about masking is going to help. Especially with a Delta variant that shows very high viral loads. When you get infected, you get a lot of the virus. And there's been some speculation whether that will mute the effectiveness of masks so much. I guess I'm just wondering if masks alone and the use of masks in this context is going to be effective without the same other elements such as social distancing.
You know, it's again a good question, Jeremy, and you're completely right to talk about and to remind people of the layers of prevention. This, and the CDC really emphasized that when they talked about schools in particular, the importance of this layered approach to prevention. That the higher the risk situation for a community at large or for certain populations, the more value there is in layering on those extra layers of protection. So in the school's guidance, they do still suggest the importance of keeping distance where possible, improving ventilation, limiting gatherings outside the classroom. So you're right about that. All of those additional mitigation measures are still very valuable. I think that the desire to just get the word out on the fact that transmission rates are so high in many counties, something that people immediately could do is just return to wearing masks indoors in those settings.
But I guess, and I'm sorry to follow up, but I mean, is it all folly? I mean, it might make us feel, but when we were saying that masking alone wasn't good enough, are we giving people the information that can actually protect them?
Well, I think all I can tell you is that I think CDC was reacting to some really fast moving data that they were aware of and just wanted to get some additional precautionary measures out to the public. But I would just personal opinion, agree with you that that's probably not the end of the conversation. But again, I just want to reiterate, I think, what we want to make sure is that the return to discussions about masking and the benefits and the consequences does not overshadow the primary importance of vaccination as the main prevention strategy. So thanks for asking.
Thank you.
All right, that is all the time we have for today. We invite any reporters with additional questions to reach out to our office this afternoon. Have a good day, and we will talk with you again soon.
This concludes today's conference call. Thank you all for joining. You may now disconnect.